So good morning one and all. So we'll start today's class with a new definition, that is independence of a random variable. So we have seen already what is independence of any two events. Now we'll study independence of a random variable. Now, so any two random variables x and y are said to be independent if, what is that? Their joint PMF, what is this? JPMF equal to product of two marginal PMFs. Okay, so px of x comma y should be equal to px of x into py of y for all x and y. Now the definition is quite simple. It's just like writing. So what is that? Probability of A intersection B equal to probability of A into probability of B. As simple as that, okay. But here we mention them with a PMF, since these two are random variables. We are dealing with random variables, not events. Yeah. Not only this, there is one more definition for independence of any two random variables, that is using conditional PMF. What is this? This is CPMF, conditional PMF. Now we know one more definition. When it comes to events, probability of A given B should be equal to probability of A. Then we say that A and B are independent events. In the same fashion, we are writing independence of two random variables using conditional PMF. So its conditional PMF should be equal to its marginal PMF. Okay. Now here, not only that, you can also write this as one more way of writing the same equation is, what do you write? Reverse. What is that? So P of y given x of y given x should be equal to what? Py of y for all x comma y. So it is also one more definition of the independence of two random variables in terms of their conditional PMFs. Now here comes the interesting part. What is that? X comma y are independent random variables, then expectation of x into y is equal to expectation of x into expectation of y. Okay. Now, so let us prove this. If x and y are independent, if x and y are independent, id random variables, then expectation of x into y should be exactly equal to expectation of x into expectation of y. Now how to prove this? First of all, let us go to the basic definition of expectation of a random variable x. What is the formula for expectation of x? What is the formula? Can you recall now? What is that? Summation over x x into its PMF, isn't it? Okay. Now what we want to write is, I want to know the formula of expectation of x into y, not x or not y, x into y. Now here it should be a double summation. Why? Because we are dealing with two random variables. Okay. Now listen carefully. What do you write here? Summation over x, summation over y. Next, we write xy into joint PMF, px comma y of x comma y. Okay, so simple way of remembering is, whatever is here, you just write in the small letters. Suppose here you have capital X, you write only small x. If here you have only capital Y, here we write only small y. Since we are having capital X into capital Y, I am writing small x into small y. So double integration, because we are dealing with two random variables at a time. And this is what is joint PMF. Why joint PMF? Because of involvement of two random variables. Okay. Next, what happens? So just now I told you, so if any two random variables are independent, this joint PMF would be equal to product of their marginal PMFs. What is that? Px of x into Py of y. Now I will replace this joint PMF with two marginal PMFs. Now what would happen finally? Summation over x into summation over y, x into y, next Px of x into Py of y. This is what you get finally. Now, so we can rearrange the summation. How can you rearrange? In what way you can rearrange them? What I do is, I will take this for one summation. Summation over x, x into Px of x. Next, I will take this summation with summation over y, y into Py of y. So what is this? Expectation of x. What is this? Expectation of y. Finally, what you can say is, if x and y are independent, please remember, it is not always true. It is true if and only if x and y are independent. Then expectation of x into y is equal to expectation of x into expectation of y. Okay. So that is proved. Now, so in the previous case, we have taken only two random variables, x and y. Now suppose if you take the function of two random variables, okay, g of x, h of y, what are they? They are functions of random variables x, y respectively. Still it is valid, okay. So it is not only valid for two random variables, along with them, it is also valid for functions of two random variables, any two random variables, okay. It is also true. Yeah. So here, please remember this. This is very, very important. I am keeping star mark. X and Y are two random variables, need not be independent. I told you so many times, but expectation of X plus Y should be equal to expectation of X plus expectation of Y. Okay. Here, x and y need not be independent. It is true always. But this is true if and only if they are independent. It is always true. This is very, very important. So the random variables need not be independent of each other. Okay. So it is something like linearity property of a random expectation. Expectation of x plus y plus z is also always equal to expectation of x plus expectation of y plus expectation of z. It is true for any number of random variables. That is a linearity property of the expectation. Now, yeah, here comes the interesting aspect of a variance. But, so when it comes to variance, variance of x plus y equal to variance of x plus variance of y. It is true if and only if they are independent. It is not always true. But, in case of expectation, it is always true. But here, variance of x plus y is equal to variance of x plus variance of y. It is true if and only if the given two random variables are independent. So let us prove this. How to prove this? So I want to prove that. What I want to prove that is, so variance of sum of two random variables, x plus y, is equal to variance of x plus variance of y. So this is true if and only if x and y are what? Independent. Okay. Now, so let me write in this way. So variance of x plus y is equal to variance of x means sigma square x plus variance of y means sigma square y. We have to prove this. We have to prove that variance of x plus y equal to variance of x plus variance of y, and in case if x and y are independent. That is true only if x and y are independent. If they are not independent, it is not true. Okay, please remember this. Now, So let us call z is equal to sum of two random variables x and y. Z equal to x plus y. Now I want to find out sigma z square or variance of z. Okay. Now, so I will denote expectation of x as mu x and expectation of y as mu y. So this is a very convenient notation for the means of the two random variables x and y. Here I want to find out variance of z. Generally, how to find the variance of z? What is the formula? Expectation of, okay, so let me go back to the previous slide. One more way here I can also write this as expectation of z equal to mu z. What is expectation of z? Can you tell me now? That equal to z is sum of two random variables. Now expectation of z equal to what is z equal to x plus y, which means here what you can write, that is always equal to expectation of x plus expectation of y. It is always true. Just now I told you it is always true. It is nothing to do with independence. It is always true. Now which means here I can say that expectation of z equal to, or simply in a simple way I can say expectation of z equal to expectation of x plus expectation of y. Okay. Now, so let us find out the variance of z. Now, what is the formula of variance of z would be? That is expectation of z minus expectation of z whole square. Are you with me? Please. Okay. Now, but what is z? Z is sum of two random variables. That implies expectation of z is nothing but x plus y minus, what is expectation of z? Mu x plus mu y. Please observe things carefully. Is it okay? Now, here this also implies expectation of, what you can write finally, I can write something like this, x minus mu x plus y minus mu y whole square. So I hope you are okay with this. Please observe the things very carefully. It is not at all difficult thing. You just, now I can, just like it is a plus b whole square, you can assume this is a, this is b. It is just like a plus b whole square, expectation of a plus b whole square. Now what do you write? That implies expectation of, so a plus b whole square means what? A square plus b square plus 2ab. What is a? X minus mu x. What is b? Y minus mu y. Okay. Now since expectation obeys linearity property, we can write that as expectation of a square plus expectation of b square plus 2 into expectation of ab. So please remember, what is a? What is b? A is nothing but x minus its mean mu x, b means y minus its mean mu y. Okay. Now here I can write this as, further I can write this as expectation of x minus mu x whole square plus expectation of b square is nothing but y minus mu y whole square. Is it okay? Now finally, plus the product term is 2 into expectation of a into b. What is a? X minus mu x into y minus mu y. Now, what is this term, first term? Can you guess? I mean, can you tell me the answer? The first term is, what is expectation of x minus mu x whole square? It is a variance of x. What about expectation of y minus mu y whole square? This is variance of y. Okay, anyway, we have to deal with this middle term. Okay, what is the term indicates? Now, so here I will write only this term. Now, 2 into, I am dealing with the product term. What I can say is x into y, let us do product. X into y, capital X into capital Y minus x minus mu y. Is it okay? Minus y minus mu x plus mu x into mu y. I have just done the simple multiplication of x minus mu x into y minus mu y. That's it. Now, so here you just now here what you have written here is, now what happens now, from this I can separate out, 2 is common, 2 into expectation of x y minus, I am writing expectation for individual terms, 2 into what is expectation of x minus mu y, anybody? That is mu y into expectation of x. Why? Suppose if I say expectation of a into x, a is a constant, then what, that is equal to a into expectation of x. Okay, now so expectation of a constant is its constant itself. Now finally, minus 2 into mu x into expectation of y. Finally, so what is expectation of mu x into mu y? Mu x, mu y are constants. I told you already, mu x, mu y are constant. So they are simply, expectation of a constant is nothing but constant itself, which means, so you'll get mu x into mu y only. Now, since x and y are independent, what is expectation of x into y? That is equal to expectation of x into expectation of y. So I am taking two common because it is present in each and every term. Now finally, this term will be equal to mu x into mu y minus, what is expectation of x? Mu y. It is there already. Minus mu x. What is expectation of y? Mu y plus mu x into mu y. Now everything gets cancels out, which means this the product term is zero. So finally we have proved that this term is zero. So we are left with only expectation of x minus mu x whole square plus expectation of y minus mu y whole square. So that is the only terms, those are two terms which are non-zero. Finally, so variance of x plus y is equal to expectation of x minus mu x whole square plus expectation of y minus mu y whole square, or in simple terms that is same as variance of x plus variance of y. So it is true if and only if, what? If and only if x and y are independent. Okay, if they are not independent, so we'll see what is the third term in the later classes. As of now, you just remember that if x and y are independent, variance of x plus y should be equal to variance of x plus variance of y. It is true for any number of random variables. If there are three number of random variables which are independent, Now what would happen? Variance of x plus y plus z should be equal to variance of x plus variance of y plus variance of z. It continues like that. Yeah. Now, so just now we were talking about independence of only two random variables. Now we can extend that idea to more number of random variables, maybe 3, 4, 5, so on, so on. Now this is very, very simple. So this is for three number of random variables. So the joint PMF will be equal to the product of marginal PMFs. It is true for any number of random variables. You can just, just now I told you, so the variance of x1 plus x2 plus so on so on xn is equal to variance of x1 plus variance of x2 so on variance of xn if and only if or independent random variables. Please, please make a note of this. Now, so that is about independence of random variable. Now, so in case of random variables, we have defined, what we defined is probability mass function. In case of discrete random variables, we have defined, we are studying discrete random variables. Now for the discrete random variable capital X, we have defined its PMF, probability mass function. How we define? Px of x equal to probability that x equal to small x. What is small x? That is any possible value of capital X, or it is a value that can be taken by this random variables, random variable capital X. Now that is a probability mass function. Now in the same way, we have one more parameter for the discrete random variable. That is called CDF. PMF and CDF. These are two important parameters of any two random variables. What is CDF? It is called cumulative distribution function. What it is called? Cumulative distribution function. What is PMF? Probability mass function. It is a cumulative distribution function. It is denoted by capital FX. We write like this. What do you write? FX, capital FX of X. This is called cumulative distribution function, or simply we call this as a CDF. Now how it is defined? Probability that capital X is less than equal to small x. How it is defined? Like this. Okay. Now, so let me write the difference properly. PMF is nothing but Px of X that equal to probability that X equal to small x. So CDF is nothing but capital Fx of X that equal to probability that capital X is less than equal to small x. Now here this very, very interesting parameter, that is CDF. CDF means cumulative distribution function. Not only that, so we use this term cumulative very often. Why? Because if I write CGPA, you know already what is CGPA means. CGPA means what? Cumulative grade point average. Okay. Now suppose, now you are in second semester. Suppose if I ask you what your CGPA, so what will you do initially? So you calculate your grade points from where? From first year, first semester to second year, first semester. Am I right? If I ask you what your CGPA, what will you do? You calculate all your grade points from first year, first semester to second year, first semester. Okay, which means you are taking the cumulative sum. So you will take your GGP, grade point average, you multiply with credits, so and so. Okay. Now the basic idea of cumulative means what? Accumulation. Cumulating things from past to present value. Okay. Suppose if I ask you same question, when you are in, let us take third year, second semester. Suppose if I ask you what your CGPA when you are in third year, second semester, what will you do? you calculate your grade points from first year first semester to second year second third year first semester, which means so you are accumulating all your grade points from starting to the present value, present time or present semester. Now same thing happens with the CDF. What is happening here? Cumulative distribution function, which means we are calculating the probabilities from starting to up to small x. X less than or equal to small x. Suppose suppose let us take small x equal to 3. For example, let us take, what is fx of 3? Cumulative distribution function when x equal to 3. X, capital X is a random variable, small x equal to 3, which means we calculate capital X is less than or equal to 3, which means we calculate probability from infinity to the 3. So what do you mean by this? It's which means probability when x equal to minus infinity. So in mass always we take minus infinity as a starting point generally. Place so on. We calculate probability that x equal to 0. Next we calculate probability that x equal to 1. So probability that x equal to 1 plus probability that x equal to 2 plus probability that x equal to 3, which means we are finding the cumulative value from past to present. What is present? Given by small x. Same thing happens with your CGPA. Okay, so the terminology of cumulative is very relative in nature. Okay, now here we are finding probability that capital X equal to capital X is less than equal to small x, which means, what do you mean by that? Now it is related to PMF. Why? Because what is PMF? So in the previous example, let me go back to the previous example. I want to find out CDF when up to x equal to 3, which means I am calculating when x equal to minus infinity, x equal so and so, x equal to 0, x equal to 1, 2, 3. But what is this? Probability that x equal to 1 is nothing but PMF, px of 1. What is this? Px of 2. Now, in the sense, it is nothing but sum of all its PMFs. Now, I can write this as px of minus infinity plus px so and so on. I am not writing all the values, it just only for explanation purpose. Now px of 0 plus px of 1 plus px of 2 plus px of 3. It is just accumulation of all the probabilities up to 3. We are starting from minus infinity and we are ending at 3. Okay. Now this can be written as summation when x equal to, otherwise let me take another simple variable, k equal to minus infinity to x px of k. Is it so? Okay, so your x is already defined. You can write this as 3. It's already defined, that's why you can write this as 3. If it is not defined, you keep as it is. Now same thing is being written here. So k equal to minus infinity to x px of k, or k less than or equal to small x px of k. So these are two definitions of the CDF. Now here you just observe the things very carefully. We are writing CDF in the form of what? PMF. CDF is written in the form of, or in terms of, PMF. Okay. Yeah. So loosely speaking, CDF accumulates probability up to the value x. It is accumulation of probabilities from minus infinity to x. Here x could be any value. We should define x just like your CGPA. Okay. So if I ask you what is CGPA, you do calculations from the first year first semester to the just before semester. Okay. In the same way, if I ask you CDF, you calculate from minus infinity to the the given value x. So it's very, very important. If x is discrete, okay, anyway, we are discussing about discrete random variable. Now, fx of x has a piecewise constant and staircase-like form. Okay, so the CDF will be a piecewise constant and staircase-like form. What is staircase? You know, there are steps like this. These are called staircases, no? Now, if you calculate CDF of any discrete random variable, it would be something like this, just like your staircases. Or steps. We'll take a, if possible, we'll take a problem. Yeah. Now, so here, what I've written here is, this is CDF, cumulative distribution function. This is PMF. Now, so we have written CDF in terms of PMF. So can we do reverse? I want to write PMF in terms of CDF. Now this is the simple notation. So PMF of PX of K is nothing but, I have told you these things in the previous classes. Okay. Now here this is PMF and these are two CDFs. Okay. So this is called, so I'm writing, you just remember, this is called first backward difference. What it is called as? First backward difference. We are just taking the difference between fx of k and fx of k minus 1. This is the CDF. This is CDF, previous CDF. Okay. Now we will solve this problem later. Now, here, so let me explain these things clearly. Now, so CDF fx of x equal to summation over k equal to minus infinity to x px of k. Now here this is CDF. Now this is PMF. Okay. Now, so here I have written CDF in the form of PMF. Now, can I do reverse? Now, what is PMF in terms of CDF? Px of k equal to CDF at x equal to k minus CDF at x equal to k minus 1. Now, this is called first backward difference. Okay, now, so you remember this relation between CDF and PMF. That is very, very important. This is PMF and these are two CDFs. Okay, now, so let us take a simple example. Okay, so let us solve this problem. So they're given a table for different values of x and the corresponding PMF. Find out its CDF. Now let us take these PMFs 0.2, 0.5, 0.1, 0.2. So if we add all these PMFs, it should be equal to 1. Correct? It is 1. So sum of all PMFs should be equal to 1. Now, so let us find out CDF. CDF can be denoted as fx of x, okay, or k. So I can also write this as fx of k or x. Okay. Now, so let us proceed. Now, if I ask you, what is fx of 0? Which means CDF up to 0. which means CDF from minus infinity to 0. Here we don't need to go for minus infinity because x starts from 1, so you can start from 1. Okay, now what is fx of 0 means? Which means sum of accumulation of, this is CDF up to 0, which means accumulation of probabilities up to 0. Now, so what are the probabilities up to 0? How many probabilities are there up to 0? No, there is no probability at all because it starts from 1. Okay, so that's why there are no probabilities up to 0. So since there are no probabilities, it is 0. Now, suppose fx of 1.5 up to 1.5, k equal to 1.5, which means probability that x is less than equal to 1.5. Now, how many such probabilities are there up to 1.5? We have only one. There is a 1.5 term. So, only term which is less than 1.5 is when x equal to 1, and the corresponding PMF is 0.2. Now here, so up to 1.5, we have only one probability, that is when x equal to 1, that equal to 0.2. Okay. Now, in the same way, if I ask you, fx of 2.1, which means probability that x is less than equal to 2.1. How many such probabilities are there which are less than 2.1? Less than 2.1 means only 2, that is 1 and 2. Okay, so at 1 0.2, at 2 0.5. so 1 and 2 0.2 0.5, it is, what will happen now? So the probabilities that are present when x is less than equal to 2.1 is when x equal to 1 plus when x equal to 2. So the probabilities are 0.2 and 0.5. so the sum of 0.2 plus 0.5 equal to 0.7. Now, if I ask you one more question, fx of what is CDF up to, maybe let us take 4.5. Probability that x is less than equal to 4.5. Can you tell me how many such probabilities, how many probabilities are present less than 4.5? Only 3. 1, 2, 3. If you sum all of them, what do you get? 0.2 plus 0.5 plus 0.1. How much? 0.8. I am not doing any calculation. It's just I'm writing 0.8. So now if I ask you, what is fx of 8? Probability that x is less than or equal to 8. How many such probabilities are there when x is less than or equal to 8? Which means we get all probabilities. Which means what? Sum of all PMFs or sum of all probabilities, that is equal to 1. So fx of 8 equal to how much? 1. Fx of 7? Fx of 7? What fx of 7 would be? It is also 1. Fx of 10? It is also 1. After 6, everything is 1. Okay? So let us draw this. So let us draw the axis. X versus its CDF or x or k. Okay, so when x is 0, what is the CDF? 0. Okay, so at 1 it is 0.2, at 2 how much is this? You calculated, no? Yeah, 0.2. next, after 2 it is 0.7, after that it is 0.8. okay, so this is 0.7 up to 4. After that it is 0.8. After that it is 1. Now, so let me indicate these things. Now, what is this value? 0.2. What is this value? 0.2, we got 0.7, next 0.8. So 0.7, this is 0.8. This is 1. Now you just, they are discontinuous. Okay, so this UDF is discontinuous. Now this is a staircase form of CDF. Okay, now what is the difference would be? What do you call this as? What is it called as? You think about this. What about these differences? What do you call them? What do you call them? They are nothing but your PMFs. Why? Because what is the PMF? The difference of two successive CDFs. If you take this difference, you get PMF back. So this is 0.2, 0.5, 0.1, 0.2. Take the difference. This is 0 here, no? Difference is 0.2. Difference is 0.5. Difference is 0.1, difference is 0.2. What are they? They are what? PMFs. How you got them? By taking the difference. What difference? Difference between any two successive CDFs. So fx of 0, fx minus fx of 1. Fx of 2 minus fx of 1. Fx of 4 minus fx of 3. FS of 6 minus FX of 4. So this is the difference between two neighboring CDFs. Now you take that, you get the PMF. Okay. Now, so this is the staircase and piecewise constant. Why you call it the piecewise constant? So if I say constant means what? It should be like this. Piecewise means it is constant in pieces. Why? Because this is constant from 1 to 2. In the same way, it is constant from 2 to 4. Again, this is constant from 4 to 6, something like that. It is not always constant. It is constant in pieces. So that's why it is called as a piecewise constant and staircase-like form. You get something like this. Okay. So one more thing, CDF can never be more than 1, obviously. What is CDF? Is nothing but accumulation of probabilities. You add all probabilities, you end up getting maximum of 1. You won't get more than 1. And not only that, it remains constant throughout the values of x. Once it reaches 1, after that it won't change. Okay. Suppose here I have taken x equal to 6. You take x equal to 100. What the value? It won't change. It is same. It remains to be constant. Okay. After certain value of x, its CDF will be 1. And after that it remains same. It remains at 1 only. Okay, so you must calculate CDF until you get 1. After that, it is same. It is always 1 only. It remains same, constant. Okay. Now, so you do one thing. You solve this problem. Where is this problem? You try to solve this problem on your own. So this is a homework. Okay. Okay, right. So we stop here. Thank you. So with this, we have completed second unit also. Okay. I will share these slides. Okay. So thank you.